Hey, welcome. There we go.
Hey, hello. Guys. This is Jimmy White from MySpeakeasy. Thanks for inviting us.
Thanks for coming on. We also have AlphaBets joining us.
Yeah.
Send an invite if they're sleeping. Who knows? Perfect. All right. People joining us as well. So your name was, what did you say, Jimmy White?
Yeah, Jimmy White.
Perfect.
Like yeah. Mr. White, you know, everybody wants to be Mr. Brown, Mr. Black. I'm Mr. White. I guess we all have the same movie references.
I love it. That's a classic right there.
Yeah.
Nice. DK, Susty, Peter, guys doing?
Great.
Well, good, Adam. Thank you. How are you, Adam?
I'm living the dream, man. Ready to do this.
Nice. How's the GMers doing, Susty?
Man, they're at a 50 sold floor price right now. Let's go. We took over the Anon. We flipped the Anon.
Yeah, that'll be interesting.
I'm about to flip B-God. Definitely flipping Utes.
Imagine. I'm wondering what's happening when all these ETH people wake up and they see 50,000 GMers on their Twitter feed.
Ooh, they're like, let me get in. Let me buy that whole collection. All it takes is one ETH whale.
That's it. All right. I sent the invite to AlphaBets. They're probably joining us soon. But we get started. So, as I said, we're going to have two products for this day. How do I pronounce this? Perfect. MySpeakeasy.
Yeah, MySpeakeasy. You got it correct. You know where it comes from?
No, I don't.
Okay. In fact, it's coming from the Prohibition era. A speakeasy was, in fact, a clandestine club. And it's coming from the bartender was telling the customer to speak easy to avoid bringing attention from the police and the authority. And then it became part of the American culture because the people that could not meet in public areas because they were gangsters or they were black or minorities, they used to go to those clandestine bars, those speakeasy. And the word speakeasy end up being a recognition brand for an underground social networking. And we really loved this idea, and we wanted to bring it on the Web3 space. So that's where it comes from. That's for the history of the name.
That ties into the entire branding and project.
So yes. Yeah. It's we start with gaming, but the idea is to create a brand around a community, and the art is promoting the vigilantes, so the guardians that are taking care of that underground clandestine social network.
Perfect. Interesting. AlphaBets joining us as well. Welcome. How are you doing?
Hi, welcome.
Hey, everyone.
Yeah.
So let's start it. Two products, AlphaBets and MySpeakeasy. I know for a fact that MySpeakeasy is an upcoming Solana product. But AlphaBets, are you going to have an NFT collection as well?
Yeah, that's right. So we're actually just exiting our private beta, and we're doing our first mainnet testing. So we have a product that's on Ethereum and on Solana, and yeah, we're integration partners with Chainlink for all of our RNG calls for our key the match to end up all the key ends of the matches. And yeah, for Solana, actually Chainlink's not on Solana, but we're using integration function that we created there. But yeah, we're doing pretty well. Mainnet's going pretty well. We haven't released to the public yet, but you can actually try our test version. Maybe I can send it here in the align with the space so people can actually try it out.
Yeah, let's do it. Awesome.
Cool.
Yeah, all right. So perfect. Two upcoming Solana projects then. And yeah, chain as well. So I want to start with just introductions. You guys can give us a brief about what you do. Then we can ask a bunch of questions to each project. And then I want to get into like general discussions. I know both of you guys are making not necessarily gambling platforms. I don't know how you want to identify yourselves, but at least some type of games. So we can discuss this all together. Perfect. Let's start it. MySpeakeasy, you want to give us a introduction and a short brief about the project?
Yes, with pleasure. So I've already explained where is the name coming from. And as you said, there's a gaming aspect of it. But it's not just the gaming, it's more a social gaming platform. So in fact, it's coming, we are great fans of the Matrix movie, like I guess most of us. And what inspired us is the scene where Neo is following the white rabbit and is meeting for the first time with Morpheus in a private room, and Morpheus is giving him the choice between the blue and the red pill. And we wanted to use that blue pill, red pill, combined with a decentralized market prediction. In fact, the idea is to try to predict what the other players are thinking. So basically, you have to guess how many will take the blue pill or the red pill amongst the players. So unlike typical coin flip or casino games that are existing in the ecosystem, here with MySpeakeasy, and that's why we call it the social gaming platform, you don't play against a smart contract. You play with and against your friends that are joining, and you need to guess the side with the fewer bets. And the best way to do this is to use the chat, which is a key component of our dashboard or platform, where you chat with the others, and while you chat with the other, you try to guess or influence them on the pill that they will take. And as I explained when I defined the name, MySpeakeasy is reviving a place where minorities and people that were rejected are meeting together. So it's not guessing what's the majority going to play. It's playing the opposite. You need to guess the side with the fewer bets and to win it. So how does it work? To make it clear, players are entering the game, entering the room. They can chat, and anytime a round is starting, every 15 seconds there is a new round that they can participate, or they can wait for the next one. And they have to choose the blue or the red pill. And while they are in the room, they use the chat to cheat and influence and manipulate. And at the end of the 15 seconds, the current round is finished, and we compute the results, and the minority gets the whole pot. So I give you an example. Let's imagine that we have 100 players all betting one soul. The result of the round in 15 seconds is 10 blue and 90 red, for example. So that means 90 soul that will be divided between the minority, so between the 10 players. So it means 9 soul distributed to each player. So it's a time 9 for a one soul bet. And the challenge, we've been working on that game since February. The challenge has been to be able to compute game results in a super speed way, so that in 10 seconds we can compute the outcome of hundreds of players joining and playing. And we've been testing it for the last 2 months. Our first version, for example, was not sustaining the load. It was taking 5 minutes to compute the results if we were having lots of players. with that new version that we've just delivered last week. Really happy because it's super fast and it's totally distributed. So people can chat, people can play, they can join one round, they can wait for the next one, and everything is very smooth. I recommend that you give it a try just for fun. Another aspect that is really interesting is it's a kind of drinking game because you can join with friends, you can book a room, and once you have that private room, you only play with your friends, which is different from the example I gave before, where anybody can join and play and chat. If you want to be just with your friends, you just book a private room. You send the invite to the list of people that you want to play with, and you will be playing with them, chatting with them, and it could be a way before going to a club or to a restaurant, you lose your drink, and each round, every 15 seconds, there's a winner, and there are losers, and the winners will force the losers to drink. It's kind of interesting social way to have fun before going to a club or to a restaurant, or even to define who's going to pay the restaurant. Where it's getting quite crazy and very interesting is if let's say an influencer it would normally raffle hype. Whitelist or one-to-one of their collection by playing more game instead of the traditional Discord or Twitter marketing promotion way of doing it. So for communities, it's a good way to entertain their followers and holders. They can come, they can book a room, they can even turn it up as they are totally private speakeasy with their own logos, their own colors, and it could be totally dedicated to their members. In this kind of private speakeasy approach, the community will have an interesting driver to promote interaction and engagement and traction amongst the members. That's for the high level quick presentation. Do you want me to give more details on the utility of the NFT
we can get into that. I just want to give the mic to AlphaBets. First of all, I just want to say we have 12 people in here. If everyone could just go, I want to get more people in here. So if everyone could just go to the pin up top or tweet this out, let's get everyone in here. And I promise these guys are going to give you whitelist. No, I'm joking. I don't know.
Why not?
AlphaBets, please give us a quick rundown of what you're building.
Yeah, so actually there's quite a lot of similarity between the MySpeakeasy product and I actually used it yesterday. I think there's definitely a need for a social gaming type atmosphere, and that's what AlphaBets is. So the concept is we created an app that puts one project versus another, like a 1v1 co-op competitive staking battle match. And how it works is we're partnering up with many different blue chip and otherwise NFT projects, and they're doing basically getting put on our fight card to have matches against each other. And how it works is you can come in and you can either stake your NFT for that other project, or you can just bet Sol. And I think this is mostly a Solana room, right? So you can just bet Sol. And those basically you're betting on which community is going to make a bigger impact within the game. So how it works is like when you stake, you don't actually have a chance to lose your NFT. It's just more or less you're basically signing a signature to say that you have the NFT and it's locking it during the duration of the match. So you can't list it, you can't sell it, but it's counting that you're here to support the project you're in and you're excited about it. Or you can actually just put in Sol And then that also counts. And then by doing that, you're obviously eligible for the larger jackpot. And yeah, so so then, and each time you do one of these two activities, not only is it making you eligible for the reward, it's actually pushing the odds in your team's favor. So yeah, I guess if you guys can go to the actual site, you can see there's like a chances stat. And every time there's an action, it actually pushes the potential for the game a little bit more toward that side. So we see that what's going to happen is going to be this like sort of tug of war match for when a match is running between the two projects to see who has the stronger community. And then ultimately, we end the match with a coin flip, and it's weighted. So if it's a 50-50, then it's a 50-50 chance on which team's going to win. But likely, it's going to be maybe weighted toward one side or another if they come in harder than the other one. So, yeah, then we do the coin flip, and the team with lower chances can actually still win. But obviously, it's less likely. But, yeah, and then the jackpot goes to both people who came in and bet. They get the majority, and then a portion goes to the people who came in and staked, which is basically like you could say it's like a risk-free bet. So meaning like you can just come, support your project, and stake your NFT and come and join the battle, and there's no risk to you, but you get to promote the project you care about. And we don't have an NFT. We don't have a token. Likely projects we're going to be doing, like Blocksmith Adam, I see yours. That's one of our partners that we're signing up. Just Ape, I see a Just Ape in here. Munapes, obviously that's a little bit tougher to get a hold of Yuga, but our team has around 3 Munapes, so we're going to definitely make a match with that. Some of these other NFTs I don't see, but yeah, I think you could pretty much assure that most of the blue chips, like our team has about 7 DGOGs, so yeah, most of the blue chips are going to be considered. So yeah, you mentioned a whitelist. We're not planning on doing any asset at the moment, but obviously the people who try out the product and who get involved and who can help us with this, they're going to be the ones who are most eligible if we decide to do an asset in the future. So thanks.
Perfect. Yeah, I saw you have some beta testing going on right now, right?
Yeah, it's fully open. I just shared with you the beta that's on DevNet. So there's not any real soul you can put in. It's more or less, you can just mint the thing as a mock-up of the NFT that would be used. And then you can put in DevNet soul just to try it out. And you can see sort of how it works. But it's working pretty much well. We're getting a final review and then an audit done. So we'll have that published for both versions, the ETH and the Solana version. And we should be launching this month, later this month.
Interesting. So what was the, sorry if I'm slow. What was the main, like what makes a, so you're putting up communities against each other, right?
Right.
What's the main thing that makes me a community win?
Yeah, it's mostly like whoever, it's still up to chance. There is an RNG call that's done at the end. If more of your one project stakes their NFT and more of one project bets more, their chances go up. So that's designed to encourage like lots of participation and also encourage people who might bet on a side that might look like it's losing, but the reward potential would be higher. So like if one side bets 10 soul, and the other side bets 2 soul, like if it's Boxman Labs, it's only 2 soul that they've bet, their reward, even though their chances are lower, their reward's gonna be way higher because there's like 10 soul to split, right? So that kind of back and forth makes it really great. And we've gone up to like some matches where we've had like 14x that people earn in like over one of the battles. So in like a 2-hour time frame, just because the odds were so off kilter, and they still won because it just happened to roll on their side. So does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, and then it's the winning side takes it all, I guess.
That's right. Losers do not get anything, but the losers who are staking their NFT never lose their NFT. They just get it back, and that's it. But the winners split the jackpot, and our revenue model is we take a percentage of the pot every game. So we take 5-7% of the overall jackpot first, and then the remainder gets split between the winners.
Right, perfect. All right, so I have some questions for you guys already. Do you know what? I want to know. What made you, what was the, when you decided to make this, is always interesting when I talk to founders and projects, like, how did you come up? What was the idea that made you think that I want to make this NFT project? Did you have some inspiration?
Yeah, so I explained previously that we like the concept of a decentralized market prediction, where in fact it's not a game that is based on a smart contract or on a bot, but on the people that are joining and interacting with each other, and that was not existing in the ecosystem, and combining this with the blue pill red pill of Matrix was a perfect because everybody understand pick the blue pill or pick the red pill, so it's making people to join and interact if the rule is complicated is quite tough, but for a market prediction, you need a simple mechanism where they have to pick between two choices, and that blue pill, red pill, was a perfect fit. So it's quite funny because we're not pushing communities to compete against the other, like AlphaBets, but we have a kind of similar philosophy. In the idea that we want to enable communities to interact with each other. And that was also one of the key reasons why we developed this, because we see that in the ecosystem, there is a lot of communities, but it's highly fragmented. And there's a need for bridges between the different communities and interactions. So we came up with this idea where communities can come and create their private speakeasy and play using our technology and have fun with their members. And one of the things that we will develop immediately after the mint is the leaderboard. So it's not exactly like AlphaBets live competition, but with the leaderboard, we will be able to show which community has been more active than the other, and we will do drops to distribute awards and prizes to the communities that are leading the game, in fact. So does it answer your question?
Yeah. And also, I'm curious about a little bit, you were starting to get into the, because you're also having the NFT collection, right?
Yes.
So, what's going to be the utility support for buying a NFT?
Yeah. Have you seen the art? The art is sick. It's
I've seen it. It's really, yeah. I like it. It's unique.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, we worked with a top pixel artist, and we gave him some guidance. We loved Matrix, Blade Runner, John Wick. We're great fans of science fiction. So, and he managed to design a very beautiful PFPs. To your question about what's the utility, we share, we charge 5% fee on the game, and that 5% is distributed 60% to the NFT owners. And the plan is we want to bring more decentralized games like the first one, and more features. And the idea is to collaborate with the NFT owners, because they get 60% of the revenues as a utility. So we really need their feedback to develop more features and to add more games and to add more social aspect to that gaming approach. So the utility is, first of all, 60% of the fees, and second of all, the fact that the next developments will be prioritized and even decided based on the feedback of the NFT owners. So there's 3% to all the NFT holders and 2% for the team. Does it answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
What are you most excited about right now? Like, we're leading up to launch and everything you're building. What's one thing that makes you excited about your project?
We are very excited about the time. It has been a real fight during the first 3 months. to manage on the blockchain to get 50 people to connect and to play and to chat and interact at the same time all together within few seconds. It has been a real challenge. And now we're really happy that finally we could make it. So time I'm playing, I'm like a kid. To see that it's so smooth and so fast, it's like a wow. Because as I said, most of the existing games in the ecosystem, you cannot play at 50 people or 100 people. An entire community cannot join and play with all these members. Any kind of coin flip game is one guy playing against the smart contract. So it's a one-to-one, not one with many. And at the same time interacting with the chat. So we have a fully distributed architecture where the gameplay is run by multiple servers, the chat is run by separate servers, the on-chain transactions are distributed and managed by different servers. It's a quite complex backend with distributed silos. And now we're really excited to launch and to start promoting this with private speakeasies. We've already been discussing with about 15 quite good communities that have asked us to enlist them for their private speakeasy. We're going to start with the public speakeasy where everybody is joining the same game room and can just book for a period of time, like 1 hour with my friends. But immediately after that first mint, we will concentrate on making it available and easy for any community to come and connect their wallet, put their logos, put their colors, change the background, and invite their communities, connect this with their Discord, and even use their own token instead of the soul. So we want to offer a bridge between SOL and any SPL token.
That's it. Yeah. All right. Like, I'm curious in general. I don't know AlphaBets, where they are, but what do you think? And maybe, Bill, you can talk about this as well. What makes, because we have a lot of gambling products, on, especially Solana, but NFT space in general. What do you think is the... Why are the NFT degens so into gambling? Is there a connection there?
Are you asking this to me? To my
speaker? To everyone, but to you as well.
Yeah, I think people on the ecosystem likes to have fun. So gambling is an easy way to have fun. But... We're not, MySpeakeasy is not just a gambling site. The chat and the interaction with the others is more important than the gambling part. Because as I said, what we want to achieve is you join with friends and you play with friends before going to a club or before going to a restaurant. When I was saying it's a drinking game, it's because drinking is an easy way to socialize. Each time you lose your drink, it's something that we've, all of us, we've done this many times, and we enjoyed it with friends. And that blue pill, red pill market prediction works perfectly fine with this approach. I wouldn't say it is a gambling. It's more of a social gaming.
No, and that's even better, right? Because then we also have the social aspect with all the videos, so that'll be even more.
Yeah.
So I want to talk to AlphaBets as well. Guys, do you plan on having, like, are you planning to build more games on your site as well, apart from this, like, community balance?
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with the MySpeakeasy sort of mythos, or the ethos, though. Of what they're doing. Like, I think there's definitely like a need for more collaborative games that also have stakes. So yeah, we actually went through a few iterations of the product before we got to here. And some of them are yeah, they're more clout driven than sort of like just cash driven. But we figure like right now it's like we're in sort of a bear market scenario, so we don't want to. I think like asking for, you know, doing another asset or like focusing on the how to make money is a key thing for a lot of people who are still in crypto. And we see this as being something that is really going to fit well for crypto oriented communities. So people who have an NFT, maybe the NFT value has gone down, but they're still communicating. They still like the vibes of the community, but they want just something to do. So we consider this to be that's the kind of energy we want to tap into. But as you know, as more brands enter the space, like Starbucks, like Nickelodeon recently did a drop, like bigger brands are just going to end up coming. So we end up being sort of this like side game that works as a utility for all these other projects that are launching. So we have a pretty heavy set of games we'll be releasing, but it's going to start with this this first one as part of that.
Nice. And I asked while you were off, I asked MySpeakeasy, what do you think is the thing that makes the Solana or the NFT degens so into like betting, gambling, stuff like that? What do you think?
I mean, it's totally cost prohibitive to do a so like obviously there's not much transactions going on Ethereum right now comparatively speaking, but like the merge happening in a few hours, that's not going to fix the gas issues that exist on Ethereum. So we're still in a situation where it's still going to be a long-term fix before we have that kind of thing. And you know, if you go on most gambling sites or where you actually have to put up money, like taking like $5 to $25 out of a transaction is serious money. I mean, that's almost the whole Solana at the top end there right now. So like, and that's when most mints are under one Solana right now. So like that compared, I mean, that's just the obvious reason up for it. But on the flip side, you know, I just think that Solana, because of low cost and because of the how popular NFTs have gotten on the blockchain, it just like providing a lot of opportunity for like ideas. Like degen coin flip would have never worked on Ethereum. I've been selling NFTs on Ethereum for, you know, almost 5 years now, and it never would have worked on Ethereum just because it's not like a mindset thing. So I think there's definitely a cultural thing it's hard to put a finger on that's on the Solana side. But it's not just the gambling part. It's like, I guess the positivity toward this kind of concept. I can't really explain it myself.
Ooh, so you're telling me that this is a Solana thing and not a NFT thing. This is more Solana who likes to bet their money on different things than NFTs.
Well, sorry, let me restate. I think every person probably in this room or who's listening on the recording is probably a bit of a gambler at heart if you're in NFTs in any way right now, because it's like there is a concept of, you know, the short-term flipping is also like inherently a form of gambling. Same with buying altcoins. So I think there's a natural congruence to that. This just makes it like our product just makes it a little bit more explicit and clear, but also it lets you join forces with others to like sort of move the outcome. So it's not just completely passive, like you're betting on a sports game and you have to find out the outcome. There's like a joint effort that goes on behind it. So that to me, it's like two things that people like in crypto, which is like having stakes and then also, you know, joining together for a single purpose. So that's what we're tapping into.
Perfect. Yeah, I also listened to, I can't remember his name, Sorcerer or something, the DGOTS guy who said yesterday, onboarding your friends into NFTs right now, you're getting them into online gambling. That's another take. So do you think, both of you guys, do you think that, because we've had, especially like lately, a booming industry of just these alternative ways to spend or use our Solana, like coin flips, yeah, different platforms where we can not only gamble, but use our Solana in other ways. Do you think this is also tied to the bear market we're in? Because we're getting, you know, we still want to spend Solana somehow, use it somehow.
I mean, I'll take that one first. Yeah, I definitely think so. I think they're like flipping NFTs actually on Solana can be profitable. We've seen that from ABC and others recently. But realistically, the liquidity opportunities are diminishing with the collapsing market. So it makes sense that people still want to get the dopamine hit plus the financial incentive. This is like an alternative way. But I would say inherently, I don't think that gambling goes away. It just gets stronger and more prevalent. It seems like it's more prevalent once the bear market hits, like when we're in the heat of it, like right now. But it always will still exist. It's always an undercurrent of crypto. It just becomes more evident right now.
Yeah, for sure. And it's funny to see this flourishing right now. What do you think, Jimmy?
I mean, I fully agree, but I'd like to push the button a little bit and try to go exactly the other way, just for the sake of being the devil's advocate. I think, as you said, people need to use their soul and find a way to justify why they're in the ecosystem. But as part of our long-term strategy, we want to connect with foundations, and we want to connect the NFT owners with endangered species, and to play, socialize, but also link their action with an endangered animal that will be receiving funding from their activity in our community. So that's why I was insisting that it's not just gambling, it's social gaming. It's a way to generate revenues and fees and wins with a high multiple for those who play and win. And down the road, to keep part of the win for them, but also to link this with a real endangered animal and save the life of that endangered. Like when we use, I don't know if you remember the Tamagotchi when we were kids.
Yes, I do.
So the idea is because your NFT could be, right now it's a vigilante that is going to protect access to our community, but it could also be a vigilante protecting an endangered animal, which will give it philosophy, an interesting philosophy, play to have fun, but also to harm some ways to save an animal.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, great. Thanks, guys. Fuck, we shouldn't need, dude, the Tamagotchi would be a perfect NFT. Could you make one of these as well, Jimmy?
That's the idea behind all vigilantes. The more you will be assisting a rhino or an orangutan or any endangered animal that you will take care of and that will receive part of your gains, the more your NFT will gain in power and in ranking in our community.
Interesting. So I'm curious, as a gambling rookie, I do not gamble so much. And I do not hold these NFTs either. But to both of you guys, are you familiar with the laws around this? Like profit sharing and everything?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm taking I'm starting responding first. Maybe AlphaBets wants to speak first. Sorry, man. Okay, thanks. I think we have to make a distinction between the guys that are playing, so the gamblers that are putting a bet and clicking on blue, red in the case of our game, and the owner of the NFT. The owner of the NFT is not a gambler. He's not playing. He doesn't have to click on blue or red. He's making 3% of the commission fees. So he's making money every time. The more people are joining and playing, the more revenue the NFT owner is getting from the game, because it's a fee that is applicable to anyone that is joining and playing. So the one who's playing has a risk of losing, and the more people are joining, the larger the community of players, the higher the multiplier of the outcome. As I said, if we have 100 players, then you get the minority is getting all the part of the majority. The outcome can be very big. But if we have 100 players, then the fees are also growing big quickly. And for the NFT owner, it's a source of income, a passive source of income.
And I also meant like more like laws, governmental laws around this.
That's why we want to, the ultimate goal is clearly to connect this with endangered species. And not sending, I mean, what is existing in the ecosystem is, okay, you want to buy yourself a good goodwill. You send money to a foundation and you don't know what's happening behind the curtain. Here it's not what we want to do. We really want to connect the NFT owner with his own Tamagotchi, so with a real animal that exists and that he will take care of.
Perfect. AlphaBets, what's your take on this?
I mean, I think it's like there's some aspects that we have to say, like clearly, an NFT that pays you out passively is a security. I mean, at least by current laws in the US and other major jurisdictions, like there's no question about that. I think the bigger thing is like when you talk about the actual game itself and the fact that you're putting in money to win more money, by the rules themselves, there is a lot of territories that this is explicitly banned. And that's why we're going to have, IP ban for the betting piece. Where these social games get really super gray area is when you start to interact and use NFTs in them, because you are technically taking an action and you're not really taking a risk. So that aspect of at least of our product, when we talked with the law firm we're working with, it was pretty clear that that aspect of it, even though it operates more or less like a staking platform, so it's still not really clear where the rules and regulations will go for that, because of like it is an action for a response. But the betting piece, there's definitely areas of like the U.S. and Europe and others that are jurisdictions that where this falls under, where it can be a major issue. And we're sort of like working ahead of time because we're like expecting to, schedule games without the consent of, major gaming publishers like Epic and like I mentioned Nickelodeon earlier, but like big brands that are entering the space, we're going to be using their assets for our games sort of without their consent. So we're sort of trying to get ahead of the eventual thing that's going to be coming for us because of that. But I'd say that for the most part, like the jurisdiction where we're where LOP exists, that's not an issue. It's actually in South Africa. It's not a big concern there locally, at least where we're incorporated. But it is going to be something that, it's going to keep being an issue as crypto gets bigger.
Yeah, for sure.
Where are you both incorporated out of?
South Africa.
What about you, Speakeasy?
Philippines. So both countries are authorized for gambling.
Awesome. So both of you have this thought out. That's nice.
Yes.
All right.
I don't want to speak too much for my Speakeasy, but some of this is about like just doing things and then not asking for permission, but asking for forgiveness. Because like so much of this is like gray area. Even most of NFTs for the past 2 years. If you try to wait to get clarity on regulations fully, you can't make new products. Like it's very clear. You'd never be able to invent anything in Web3. Nobody would have ever created DeFi. We wouldn't have Uniswap. We wouldn't have all these products. Nobody took a chance and sort of went out. So I think that I applaud like MySpeakeasy and others who just sort of put young things for the sake of Web3.
Yeah, I had a little hard time hearing the last part there. And also, Jimmy, I sorry if I mute you, but there is some background noise, so I have a hard time hearing the others. Feel free to unmute at any time. Yeah, guys, I want to give you, I'm from my research, since I've been doing this, the average attention span for the Solana degens is 1 hour. And we're almost touching on the hour here. But I just want to give you guys the mic, right, to share anything exciting, anything last you want to share with everyone listening that's here right now or listening to this as a recording. So let's start it with AlphaBets.
Yeah, so like you said, there's not really any asset for us to buy or for you guys to buy. Like we're launching this and we're like asking the community to help us really make the game better. And we're using adoption and revenue as a driver for enhancements. So if you'd like to get involved with the beta, we did a initial program. We're going to be auctioning off, raffling off a Utes. But if you join the beta, you can actually get free tickets for that raffle. So as a way to say thank you for trying out our product and helping us find any bugs. So if you'd like to join, our Discord's in our bio. And and we already posted the link to the product itself.
As you said, like the beta users, the early adopters, is also going to have, like, I guess, benefits for everything you guys do, especially like NFT collection, stuff like that.
For sure.
Perfect. Check it out, guys. All right, Jimmy. Anything that you want to share with everyone?
Yeah, pretty similar to AlphaBets. The game is live. We're promoting people to come and play and help us find some bugs if there are. So we're promoting a whitelist to those who are helping us on that matter before the mint. The mint for the public will be at 2 SOL. But those who are joining the game and playing with us, they will get it at 1.5 if they get the whitelist, and we're still offering some whitelist space to the early adopters.
Perfect. So anyone listening who want to get involved and get access to this, what do they do, Jimmy?
They just come to our Discord, join, and play. We're organizing rounds every day. They come, they join, they play, and they get the whitelist.
All right. This has been the pod with AlphaBets and MySpeakeasy. Guys, thank you so much for coming on. And hopefully, all of you listening have some better knowledge about these two projects, about the revenue share, about the loss for this. I've learned a lot. Thank you guys so much for coming on.
Thank you, Adam.
Also, shout out to our sponsors for tonight. See, we have them in the listeners as well. Jack, who's building Hyperlaunch. Also got some other exciting upcoming stuff here very shortly. But Hyperlaunch is a permissionless launchpad that anyone can launch their NFT collection on without writing a single line of code. Just enter the collection details and get your customized minting page for your brand and style instantly. I want to ask you, Jimmy, have you guys decided on any launchpad?
Sorry, I was on mute. We're working with Magic Eden, but we're doing it with Magic Eden. Why?
Yes. Jack coming up as well. Welcome, Jack. No, we were talking about the Apple launch, the launchpad that's sponsoring us for the night. But Marikina is awesome. What's up, Jack?
Hey, guys. Hey, sorry, I was working. So it's really good. Hope your launch goes well. It sounds interesting. Sounds like a great project. And if you have a whitelist, give it to me. And if you want to consider Hyper launch, that's okay. Also. But good luck. When are you launching, by the way?
We're waiting for Magic Eden to give us a date, but very likely before end of September. We're ready.
Sounds good.
So, but we can have a private direct chat also on what you can offer to help us.
Yeah, so we can have a private chat. If you want to look at the website or the basic features that we provide, We're in private beta right now. So obviously, a lot of stuff is being built and handhold any collections. We're handholding first 10 collections just to make sure everything's working all right. And we can, if you choose to, we can certainly help you launch on our platform.
Okay. Okay. So let's have a chat. And I'll introduce you also to my my co-founder, Morpheus. The more connection we have, the better. So that's
our chat. Absolutely. Sounds good. Certainly, I followed you and just DM me, and we can have a conversation on Discord or Google Meet, Hangout, Microsoft Teams, anything.
Telegram.
Metaverse.
Yes, of course.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. Yes.
Love it. All right, guys, everyone speaking, listening, anything. Thank you guys so much for coming on and showing up tonight. And also, of course, we're going to open a Hangout space so we can chill out. And to the projects, again, thank you for coming on. See you guys tomorrow. Maybe I should tell you who's coming on tomorrow. We're going to have Nekosuma and Bussy Bors. And Bussy Bors is going to give, from what I've heard, access to their beta platform, which is they call it the fiber of Web3, but it's a job. Platform to get you guys jobs in Web3 so you all can join us full time. So that's for tomorrow. Thank you guys for today and see you in the after party.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm about to pull out. History's been cursed. Yeah, we've been waiting so long. Yeah, we might have talked now. Hotter bread and we burn. Cause I've been feeling cold time. Having fucking cold time. Yeah, I'm on the Bud Light, not the bourbon. I might chop the roof off the Suburbans. Trying to be a nice guy, down turns. Till I started throwing up in your parking. Then I woke up in the morning. Police showed up at my door with a warrant. I said my flush was something down the toilet. Is he gonna let me off with a warrant? I'm about to pull up. This is what's coming.